Hello, First Presbyterian and community friends, and welcome to evening Vespers. I know many of us are used to and miss being in our chapel as we share Vespers in the evenings, and we've enjoyed this series on the parables together, and I hope that we can continue in that series tonight, even though we aren't together and we're not in our chapel. But know that we are together in spirit, and that we also are together when we read God's word and pray together. There are so many ways that we can continue to be church, and there are so many ways that you all are continuing to be church together. I'm going to start our Vesper time with an evening prayer. It's actually from the daily prayer book of the Presbyterian Church. So please pray with me. As you have made this day, O God, you also make the night. Give light for our comfort. Come upon us with quietness and still our souls, that we may listen for the whisper of your Holy Spirit and be attentive to your nearness. Empower us to rise again in new life, to proclaim your praise and show the light of Jesus Christ to a dark world. For he reigns forever and ever. Amen. Tonight we're going to be reading and reflecting on the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, or some call it the 10 virgins, or even the 10 torchbearers. It is a parable of waiting and watching, a parable of expectation and readiness. It's also a parable that's part of a series of the parables that were written around the last days. And if you remember the book of Matthew was always had the last days in mind as he was reminding us about the last days of Christ and the imminent return of Christ. He was preaching to the Jewish community, and it was an expectant time for the Savior. I would encourage you during this Facebook Live, if you would like, to put any of your wondering questions down in the Facebook comments. When I chose this parable a number of months back, I was excited about the fact that I didn't know it very well. And boy, are there lots and lots of questions and wondering in my mind as I've read and studied this parable, and I'm sure that you may find some of the same yourself. So as we're reflecting together on the scripture, I'd encourage you to put some of those wondering questions in the comments. Well, this is a parable that has the setting of a wedding. And as you know, there were several stories in scripture about weddings. Now, when we think about a wedding today, I don't know if you've been to one recently. If you haven't, you've probably seen some of the wedding shows on TV. Maybe you've watched The Bachelor, or I've watched a recent one called Love at First Sight, and it's all about weddings. So, weddings, weddings, weddings. Well, weddings today and weddings in the time of Christ were quite different. And so tonight we're going to hear about a wedding in the Palestinian first century village. And I will tell you that even though today there are many, many things that compete with weddings, in that time it was a highlight of the community. Everyone came to the weddings of the community, and they were quite the celebration. So, understandably, all else in a Palestinian village was put aside for a wedding. And when Jesus leaned forward and said, "Let me tell you about a wedding. He need say no more in order to have the full attention of everyone." So listen to this story about the 10 bridesmaids. If you have your Bible, you can get it out and follow along and think about those wondering questions. I think before we delve into that scripture, I'm also going to light the Christ candle that I have here with me. This candle is one that I often light, especially in recent days, to remember the light of Christ that's present with us, the light of Christ that fills these sometimes dark days. So listen to the parable of the 10 bridesmaids. "Then the kingdom of heaven will be like this." Remember, we're talking about kingdom people, kingdom living. 10 bridesmaids took their lamps and went to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them were foolish and 5 were wise. When the foolish took their lamps, they took no oil with them, but the wise took flask of oil with their lamps. As the bridegroom was delayed, all of them became drowsy and slept. But at midnight, there was a shout, "Look, here's the bridegroom. Come out to meet him." Then all those bridesmaids got up and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise replied, "No, there will not be enough for you and for us. You had better go to the dealers and buy some for yourselves." And while they went to buy it, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went with him into the wedding banquet, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came also, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he replied, "Truly I tell you, I do not know you. Keep awake, therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The bridesmaids, 5 were foolish and 5 were wise. Which ones were foolish and which ones were wise? Jesus reminded us that we will not know the time of his return, but to be prepared. Preparedness. And then later in Matthew 25, we hear about judgment. All of the bridesmaids were waiting faithfully. All of the bridesmaids fell asleep. It was dark. They were waiting to carry their lamps to the wedding festival. They were waiting for the bridegroom. We never knew in Palestinian weddings when the bridegroom would arrive. It was up to him, and some people say that maybe he delayed and waited so that everyone could make it to the celebration. The bridesmaids, who often carried the lamps as part of a processional in the village, were the ones that would go out and be ready to process in the village, bringing everyone to the party. They all brought oil. And yet, when the time came, when the bridegroom actually arrived, even though he was very late, all of the bridesmaids had gone to sleep. And yet, when they woke up, when they heard the shout that the bridegroom was here, they began to trim their lamps so that they could carry their lamps, inviting everyone to come to the party. But the foolish ones had let the oil in their lamps run out, and they had no extra oil. It was the wise bridesmaids who had extra oil. They trimmed their lamps and got ready to set off to the wedding celebration. The other bridesmaids asked them, "We don't have enough oil now. Can we borrow some from you?" And they actually said, "No. You need to go and get oil yourself. Go into the village and buy some more oil." So they actually did. They ran back to the village, wanting to be ready, wanting to be part of the party, wanting to not miss out. They went back and bought oil and came to the party. But unfortunately, they were too late. The wise bridesmaids had carried their torches, their lamps were trimmed, their lights were shining brightly as they were processing and inviting others to the party. And then when the foolish bridesmaids arrived, unfortunately, the door was shut. The bridegroom said that he did not know them. And we are told to stay awake, to be alert, to be ready. So what did it mean for all of these bridesmaids that were waiting, waiting for the bridegroom, waiting for the party, waiting for the celebration? What does it mean today for us to wait? If you're like me, you feel like we're waiting a lot these days, and sometimes it feels like we're waiting in the dark. We're waiting in grocery lines. Some of us are waiting for checks, unemployment checks, stimulus checks. We're waiting to hear about school. We're waiting. We're waiting. We're waiting for a cure. We're waiting for a vaccine. We're waiting for church to gather again. We're waiting for things to return to normal. Waiting is hard. And these days, it seems that waiting is often filled with fear and anxiety, with worry and stress. So how does the passage help us to know how to wait, not only individually, but as a church, as a community? We might get some help by thinking about the fact that if we trust in God's promises, if we trust in God's promise to enter into these present moments at faithful waiting, that Christ will appear, that Christ is present. The oil that was used to trim the lamps is often thought of as the oil that represents the Holy Spirit. The indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our lives gives us courage. It gives us comfort, especially during dark times. So maybe when the door was shut, it wasn't about salvation. It was about how we wait, how we anticipate the Savior, how we faithfully wait during dark and uncertain times. The wise bridesmaids had extra oil. They had the inner oil of the Holy Spirit that helped to light their way, especially in the dark. Let's think about other ways that the Holy Spirit, that oil, may dwell in us. We might think about faithfully waiting as a way to consider what it means for our inner and our outer life of faith. when we consider the inner dwelling in the Holy Spirit, we can make room for the Spirit. We can make room for the Spirit to work by practicing allowing the Spirit to be open in our lives. A few of the ways that I've found that I enjoy practicing, especially during these dark and uncertain times, are by not only reading scripture and praying like we're doing tonight, but another way that I've found that my heart has been open to the presence and the nearness of the Holy Spirit dwelling in me and around me and through me has been through being outside. What a blessing it's been that we've been able to be out in nature during these hard and uncertain times. Just being outside, whether you enjoy gardening or sitting on your deck or exercising, being in nature, being in God's creation is one spiritual practice that can open up your heart and allow the closeness and nearness, that presence of God as we faithfully wait. Finding time for silence. I know this is a great challenge for many of you that may have young children at home, but I would encourage you, if even it's only a few minutes, that you practice some silence each day. Turn off the news, turn off all of the noise, and take a few minutes to meet God in the silence. Sometimes even just lighting a candle for a few moments and enjoying that peace and quiet can help you to feel that nearness to the Holy Spirit. Another practice that you might enjoy is reading the Psalms. We're going to end our time together tonight by reading Psalm 91, and I would encourage you to find some time to read the Psalms, to meditate on the Psalms, to chew on the Psalms, to let them sink into your soul. The Psalms are a beautiful way to practice, again, opening our hearts to the nearness of the Holy Spirit. Maybe find some time to create something. Once again, the Holy Spirit often works in creative ways. Finding time to make something, whether it's something in your kitchen, a piece of art, a piece of music, anything that you can make or create, once again, opens up your heart, opens you up to the indwelling of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And speaking of the arts, music is another way that I enjoy drawing close to God, listening to music to quiet your soul and allow the Holy Spirit to be present and dwell there. All of these inner dwellings of the Holy Spirit, the ways that we practice opening our heart and making room for God, are ways that help us to faithfully wait. They help us to develop a relationship with God that draws us closer to God and helps us during these difficult and dark and uncertain times. All of these practices, and these are just a few, I'm sure that you have some that you enjoy practicing. But these practices often lead us, these inner spiritual practices, lead us to outer spiritual practices, acts of compassion and acts of justice. And that's where the passage leads as we go later into the book, later into the chapter of Matthew. There's that famous passage of judgment about the sheep and the goats, and we're reminded that Jesus was the one that was present when we were feeding the hungry, when we were clothing the naked, when we were visiting those in prison or in hospitals, when we were caring for those who are sick, when we were in the front line, caring for all of those who need us most. So I would encourage you not only to continue being the church and faithfully waiting by developing these inner practices, this inner dwelling of the Holy Spirit, but also remembering that these lead to fruitful and faithful acts of compassion in our community. And those of you, once again, who also are involved in not only acts of compassion, but acts of social justice, taking the next steps, not only feeding the hungry, but working to make change, to make policy change, working for justice and equality, working for systemic and institutional change. All of these are ways that we can continue to faithfully wait, to trust in God's promise to be present in this time of uncertainty and in this time of waiting, faithfully waiting for Christ, faithfully waiting, living a life that is infused by the Holy Spirit, a life that brings us courage and hope and promise during these times, a light like the light of the torchbearers in the parable, a light that shone in the darkness, a light that helped them to faithfully wait. Tonight, as we prepare to end, I would encourage you to think about how you are faithfully waiting. One of the ways that, as a staff at First Presbyterian, that we have found ourselves being encouraged when we meet by Zoom or by phone is by sharing stories with one another of the ways that we are observing and hearing how First Presbyterian is being the church, how they are faithfully waiting in solidarity, how they are being community to one another. So thank you for all of the ways that you are faithfully waiting. We'd love to hear more. If you'd like to put them in the comments, we'd love to hear about all of the ways that you are faithfully waiting. And thank you again for being the church together, especially during these dark and uncertain times. Know that Christ is with you, that the Holy Spirit is dwelling in you, and the Holy Spirit is active and working in your life and in the life of our church. Amen. I'm going to end our time together by reading a psalm, and this is Psalm 91. And I would invite you to listen to the psalm this evening, and I would also invite you to read it on your own tonight and maybe every night this week. Listen to Psalm 91. You who live in the shelter of the Most High, who abide in the shadow of the Almighty, will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. For God will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness is a shield and buckler. You will not fear the terror of the night, or the arrow that flies by day, or the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, or the destruction that wastes at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will only look with your eyes and see the punishment of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your refuge, the Most High your dwelling place, no evil shall befall you, no scourge come near your tent. For God will command God's angels concerning to guard you in all your ways. On their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent you will trample underfoot. Those who love me, I will deliver. I will protect those who know my name. When they call to me, I will answer them. I will be with them in trouble. I will rescue them and honor them. With long life, I will satisfy them and show them my salvation. This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Amen.